Hi, welcome back to another edition of Relatable. I'm your host, Stephanie Michelle. We might be talking about issues today that you can't relate to, but if you are a person that cares about fundamental rights, I urge you to stick around for this conversation. We're going to be talking about how a cisgender person, and that would be me, so if you don't have never heard this term, that's someone whose gender identity corresponds with their biological sex assigned at birth, so I'm cisgender, can understand and be an ally for a transgender person, a person whose gender identity does not correspond to the person's biological sex assignment at birth. So how can these two people be more supportive, particularly a cisgender person to a transgender person? Notice I'm talking about gender identity and not sexual orientation, one's natural preference and sexual partners. Gender identity and sexual orientation are not mutually exclusive. You're probably hearing about trans people in the media and trans issues in the news, but by no means does this mean that there are more trans people in society, in today's society, than in our history. Transgender people have been present in the United States at least since the 1600s that we know of. Before Western contact, some Native American tribes had a third gender people whose society's roles varied from tribe to tribe. People dressed and lived differently from their sex assignment at birth and contributed in different various aspects of American history and culture and have been documented since the 17th century to present day. I know how easy it is to fear something or someone that's different from you, but I also believe in a time where fear is present in everything and everywhere that we turn, that we all need to be more curious with each other and find ways to be inclusive and lean into our connected humanity. I believe that being an active ally for someone that is different from you is an exceptional way to experience your own humanity, which is why I'm thrilled to have my guest today here to share how we can do this. So this is Kyle Sawyer to my left here. Kyle is the founder of Building Allies, an organization dedicated to turning privilege into change. Kyle's a longtime trans activist and spends most of his time connecting his passions to social justice. Kyle has conducted many lectures and workshops regarding active allyship to the trans and non-binary communities to help educate individuals, organizations, and service providers in the development of their own active ally behavior. I love this. I wanted to say more. Welcome, Kyle.
Thank you. I'm really glad.
Kyle and I have been talking since we moved the studio over here, and I'm so glad that we're now finally sitting down and having this conversation. Kyle, so I ask everybody before we jump into, you know, our topic for the day, to is there anything that's like pulling your attention that you want to share before we get into what we were planning to talk about today, that you just want to put it out there?
Yeah, well, before that, I want to address something you said earlier about biological sex assigned. Mm-hmm. Using the language sex assigned at birth is meant to replace language of biological sex,
okay.
Right? So many trans folk, myself included, my biological sex is trans, okay. Right? That's for me. And so we want to just use sex assigned at birth.
Sex assigned at birth, so
yeah.
That's a better way to say that. See, already we're
right.
Learning. This is what we're here to do, because I know people that are watching, people yeah. In my own family, like they haven't had an opportunity to have a conversation right. Like this. So hopefully we can, you know, put some things out there that make it easy for people to understand and
right.
Learn. So I've already learned something and I appreciate that.
Yeah, no problem. That's what we do.
That's what we're here for, right?
Right, yeah.
All right, so Kyle, tell me a little bit about your story. You know, what was your personal motivation for right. Co-founding or founding Building Allies?
Well, it started many years ago. When I was first coming out as trans, I was searching for support, and I found a group in Orange County. Mm-hmm. And through that group, I was connected to the PFLAG Speakers Bureau. And what we would do is we'd go to a bunch of college classrooms, share our story, and chat. And that was really great, and it felt great. And did it for about a couple of years. And I went into this one school that myself and many folks from this group, you know, went to and spoke to classes. And I did my spiel. I told them about my transition, all of that. And about a week after that, a trans person was attacked on campus violently. And it just sort of was like, well, then what am I doing? Mm-hmm. And that was really when I realized the amount of privilege I hold in many ways. And as I began to be read more as male, the support and, you know, space in the world mm-hmm. just expanded mm-hmm. beyond my belief. I had no idea. So through that, I wanted to change from telling my story, which was a very single story, and educate. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, over the years, I've taken some trainings with a great organization called Training for Change. And now we offer experiential workshops where we focus on participants' lived experiences mm-hmm. rather than sensationalizing trans lives. And what's so cool about that is that every person in their small world can create change. Mm-hmm. And it's going to look different. It's going to look as different as each person looks. And so we get to work with participants, take them through experiences or through exercises and games to where they can develop their own active ally behavior and what that looks like for who they are as a mm-hmm. as a person.
And is that why you had to really call it active ally too? Because what I'm hearing and what you just shared is there's context. Like right. you, even in your own story, you realized there's layers to this and you're always gonna be learning right. and you're always gonna be growing. And so it's not like someone can just take one course, a couple hour course, right. and go, oh, I'm an ally, I get it.
Right.
You know, because things are changing, right? Right? So there's something about being an active ally which right. opens the door for that context and learning is.
Yeah, and well, there's some really strong critique out there around ally and mm-hmm. what that looks like and how it can be performative. Mm-hmm. We just launched a blog yesterday where we link many of these resources and talk about what active allyship looks like. Mm-hmm. And, you know, being an active ally, becoming an active ally, it's an act of becoming, right? As we grow, as we become aware of our privileges, become aware of the marginalization that we are a part of, mm-hmm. right? I don't intentionally harm, but I benefit, right? I benefit from the oppression of others just by existing. Mm-hmm. So as we become aware of that, we can move into action, and what through action is where we can start to learn how to use the privileges that we have. Like I have white passing, I have cis male passing privilege. I basically have it when I'm perceived out in the world. I use nail polish and my purple hair to help express myself a bit, but mm-hmm. I still exist as I do.
I think,
right?
Let's talk more about privilege, because I think that's a topic, again, someone listening, haven't had this conversation.
Sure.
What more can we say about that to really help people understand, even though you may not identify yourself as having privilege, mm-hmm. How some things that you have are oppressing other people, or what can we say about this?
Well, first, privilege is not a bad word, not at all. It's a way to identify the benefits. Mm-hmm. So, for example, when before I started being read as cis male, I was perceived, I'm a mixed race person, mm-hmm. and as perceived as a, let me start over.
This is important. This is important. I know why you're pausing, because it's a really important thing to make clear or help people understand. Yeah.
Yes, and it's also, it's layered, mm-hmm. right? So right now we often talk about white privilege. So let's talk about that, right? Mm-hmm. So what that's both a personal experience as well as a systemic, mm-hmm. right, issue. And you can look at it in terms of housing loans, right? There's history, it has been shown that those that are perceived as white or are white are getting much better rates in this area, right? And that's not a person's life, mm-hmm. right? So on the other extreme, what we're looking at is we have these male white mass shooters, and they are going in and they are killing children. They're killing everybody. Mm-hmm. And the response to that is compassion, it's care, it's let's put a bulletproof vest on you and take you to Burger King. right? And then you have a child who's walking home be shot to death because he's perceived as a threat. And he's an African American child. Like mm-hmm. he's a young child, 12 years old. Mm-hmm. This is privilege. It's this something as small as you get better loans, you get treated better, a cab's gonna stop for you mm-hmm. and give you a ride, to not having to worry about getting shot, mm-hmm. being able to call the police and feel safe, mm-hmm. right? We just saw this happen in Brooklyn, right? Somebody came in, moved in, part of the gentrification of this neighborhood, calls the police on somebody who's been there for 20 years, police show up and kill this man. African-American man, of course, mm-hmm. right? And so there are so many layers to it. And it's a process of becoming aware and realizing like it's there whether we want it to be there or not, right? Yeah, you can be a good person and have privilege. You can be a good person and still benefit because of it's a system in which we live.
Mm-hmm. So how do we use privilege to help somebody? So if we, first mm-hmm. step is kind of acknowledging that it's there.
Awareness.
And it's not bad or good, and I like you yeah. saying that, it's not a bad word. How do we use yeah. it to help others that don't have it?
Right, well, so if you're in a position of hiring, who are you hiring, right? If you're standing in line at the grocery store and you don't get checked for your ID for using a check, but the African-American woman behind you does, say something, mm-hmm. stand up, like call it out, right? Are you a person who goes to rallies? Did you go to the Women's March and wear your pink hat? Great, did you also go to the Black Lives Matters rallies? Because, you know, I'm guessing not, mm-hmm. right? And so it's within the context of your life. Are you hearing, using your privilege to challenge the folks in the room, right? I can have certain conversations because of the way in which I'm perceived, and so I have those conversations with other folks who are perceived as white or who have a similar layers, levels of privilege as I do. We have these conversations mm-hmm. with each other, right? There are some really simple things that can be done, and then there's some much more complex. It really will vary on who you are and the way in which you want to have these conversations. And, you know, as you're learning about it, fine, there are many organizations out there that are talking about this, right? You can educate yourself. I mean, we do a lot of this work as well. Mm-hmm. There's countless that there are ways to go find education for yourself without asking somebody to do emotional labor for you.
What do you mean by that? Like,
well, it's like folks early on in my transition mm-hmm. would. I would be the token trans person, right? Talk to these schools, come talk to our group. A friend of mine is dealing with this right now, mm-hmm. right? Do this, but we're not gonna pay you for your labor. We're gonna use you. We're not gonna take, you know, we're not gonna do any of these other things to honor that you're doing this work, right?
And also what comes up for me now that you said that, now that you clarified that. So if you're a person like me, you know, white lady, you know, that
right.
that's cisgendered. Am I saying that right?
Yeah.
Yep. If I meet somebody that's trans, mm-hmm. I should be curious about the person and be respectful about the person, but not go to them and go, tell me everything, or
right.
Use them as my source to try to learn.
Right.
Is that kind of...
Yeah. Well,
because that's a lot of...
It's that, how do you meet anybody, right?
Yeah.
Right. When I meet a new person, I don't ask them to tell me their whole life story.
Right.
What's your medical history?
Yeah.
Right.
Respectfully curious, right? Isn't that?
Well, yeah. Right. I mean, it's in the process of meeting somebody. Yeah. Right. But what often happens is that those of us who don't fit within the white cisgender hetero patriarchy are deemed other, and then are expected to tell you our life story. And it comes from a history, right? Before the internet, those in there was a big tell your story, share your story, telling, mm-hmm. and that's, yeah, do that, because how else, right? Now we have the internet, and there are many people who are telling their story, mm-hmm. and I want to share their story,
mm-hmm.
right? So asking the person you think is the only trans person you know to do this is just inappropriate, mm-hmm. and it's disrespectful to a human being,
mm-hmm.
right? So I just think if you want to know these stories, you can find them, mm-hmm. right? There's so many out there. It's freaking fantastic.
Find a training like yours.
Or find a training like mine, right. Yeah, exactly. We do public trainings. Come on over. That's a great place mm-hmm. to bring your questions, mm-hmm. right? I'm saying, yes, this is where it is. So yes, come, bring your questions. Let's talk about this.
Are there questions, common questions that come up in these workshops that you always have to address?
Typically depends on the group, mm-hmm. but folks are often curious about pronouns. So we do an exercise around pronouns, which involves, so for example, what you could do at the start of your show is, mm-hmm. hi, I'm Stephanie, my pronouns are she, hers, and then what I usually do but didn't do today would be, hi, I'm Kyle, my pronouns are they, him. And you just start off that way, mm-hmm. right? And then you go on. So that's something that we talk about. It varies because, sorry, go ahead.
On that, how if we did that, mm-hmm. I kind of want to start the show over and do that. Right. If I messed up, right. you know, if I messed up your pronoun,
right.
like how's the best way to handle that? Like how do you handle that? Because it's a training.
Sure, yeah. There's a switch in your brain that's happening. Yeah, it's really simple. If you know that you messed up, which you didn't, but if you know that you did, mm-hmm. just correct it and move on, mm-hmm. right? If because what sometimes can happen is it becomes a big thing, right? Like, oh my gosh, I'm so sorry, and then I end up having to take care of you in your guilt and shame right. about messing up, right? Yeah. And I don't. But it's not about you,
yeah.
right?
Yeah.
But it's like, it's okay, you messed up.
Yeah.
Fix it and move on,
Yeah.
right? And fix it and move on.
Just in the moment, go, okay.
Yeah, and there's a tip of practicing in your mind. Mm-hmm. We linked a video on our Facebook page mm-hmm. to a Biff and I is an activist. Mm-hmm. Where they talk about one of the things you can do is practice in your mind. Think mm-hmm. about the person in your mind. Have a conversation with mm-hmm. them so that you can practice using that correct pronoun. I thought that was a great tip.
I think it's a great tip. It would be the same way. I'm terrible at pronunciation sometimes. Yeah. And I'll carry a little fear around it if I right. mispronounced your name. Like, nobody wants to do that.
Right.
But the way that you get around it is practice, practice, practice. Yeah. And I like this too. So I pulled this off of a resource off your site. So, mm-hmm. You know, this is the best that I've heard to get the they and the their in your mind. Mm-hmm. Since it's really simple in English, we already use singular they all the time when the gender of a person is unknown. Say you see $50 on the ground and pick it up and you might say, oh, someone dropped their money here. I'll set mm-hmm. it aside for them. I bet they're looking for it everywhere. Mm-hmm. That was helpful to me.
Yeah.
That was helpful to me that we already use a singular they. Because when you were first mm-hmm. introduced to it, you're like, well, that's plural and that's weird. And it's grammatically, you know, mm-hmm. I everything that I was trained in elementary school is like going off in mm-hmm. my head. That makes sense to me. Yeah. That made sense to me. Is there any other things that you tend to?
Well, one of the dictionaries, I think Oxford or Webster, mm-hmm. one of the big ones.
Of those guys.
Yeah. I can't remember because Oxford just introduced a bunch of new language. They is now officially
that's
a singular.
Awesome.
So if folks use that as an argument, well, actually, whoever decides these things has decided.
That is singular.
But not that matters. I think about gender neutral mm-hmm. pronouns, I think they're wonderful. I think they're spectacular. I think if folks are using those pronouns, it's legit. It doesn't matter who or what authority says it is. The authority is that person, right? And it's not that hard, actually. I 6 years ago or so, when I was first being introduced to gender neutral pronouns, a friend of mine was using them. And at the time, I was really struggling. And I went up to them and I said, hey, is it actually okay if I'm really having a hard time with this. Is it okay if I use he pronouns? That's what I used before. And they were like, yeah. And then about 6 months later, I'm doing a workshop and I'm talking to people about pronouns and I realized what I had just done. Like, and it's 6 months later, mm-hmm. right? And it's like, wow, really? I just put my difficulty with changing language more important than somebody's identity, like who they're being, mm-hmm. Is not cool at all. And I had to go back to that person and say, own it. Like, it just kind of hit me what I did in that moment.
You know what's coming up for me in this is, I think the challenge maybe in this is how quickly, how much judgment is in our culture? Mm. The tremendous amounts of judgment in everything that we do, social media, online dating, everything. Mm. We're making quick judgments all the time. That's the condition that we live in. And in reality, like, no matter who you are, if you're living, you're probably growing and you're going through different things. And like, what might have been okay 6 months ago is no longer okay. Like, I think our last guest had this epiphany about she's blonde and she would make blonde jokes. And at some point she was like, this is kind of insulting to myself and I'm not gonna make these. And I wanna make sure other people know they shouldn't be making them around me either, right? So what's coming up for me is I'm sad about it, but like the sadness around what little emphasis we put on relationship and the journey of relationship and checking in with people and being curious, because at any time you could change your I could change my pronouns today, you could change your pronouns today, and that's okay. That should be okay. But we're not, I don't know, there's not a feeling of being in relationship enough where people go, okay, that's who you are today.
Right.
I'm cool with that.
Right.
That just makes me sad. I don't know how else to like bring it up, but
That's real. I mean, that's the system in which we live, right? Who benefits from all of that? I mean, it's not us, it's the one percenters, it's the cis straight white guys. They benefit. This is their system. And so when you don't fit within, it's everywhere, right? You can see it everywhere. And that's what becoming an active ally, that's what it's about, is paying attention, being aware of all of it, right? Like, what kind of accessibility do you have, right? Are you paying attention to disability rights activists? Are you, what kind of access do folks have to education? Where are you putting your money, right? That's a big question. We live in a capitalist society, so where are you putting your money? Right? Are you doing the research to find black-owned businesses? Right? Are you? It's just that these are the questions you have to ask, and it feels really big. It can feel like a lot, but it's not. It's just one step. It's just one thing.
Well, that's. I would imagine that's what people are opposed to the most when we start talking about this. Well, when am I going to have time to do anything in life if I'm, trying to keep up with all this stuff? But just like we talked about, you're already in transition in your life, you're already growing. Like, you can add layers to this. Yeah. You can decide that you're going to seek out black-owned businesses, and then the next layer is you're going to use your voice when you hear something that's wrong. Like, you don't have to look at it as this overwhelming thing you have to do right this moment, but just be open to the momentum of like, okay, I want to do better about this. I'm going to go to a march that I've never gone to.
Right.
I'm going to take a workshop, Like, I don't think it needs to be overwhelming. I think it's a basic principle of humanity, of like connecting to people. And I think in general we all need to do that a little bit more. We've like lost our curiosity with each other, and we're just judging and quick dismissing, and it's saddening to me. I mean, that's kind of
what I think it's that, but I think there's also complacency around it, right? Is that, what are we doing? Right, we want to build relationships. That's great, let's build relationships, but are those relationships genuine if I'm still benefiting and not challenging how and the ways in which I'm benefiting? Right, like, that's, yes, I could, let's build relationships, let's be friends, and let's be active allies, right? It can't just be about who are you, it has to be how am I showing up in this? Mm-hmm. What are the ways in which I benefit? What are the ways in which I don't challenge that? Mm-hmm. Right, because there are always ways to challenge that, from seemingly small to seemingly large. Mm-hmm. Right, there are ways. I mean, bodies are on the line, humans are on the line with this. Animals. I mean, we are on the line, right? Mm-hmm. And so, those of us with privilege, we have to step up. We have to put our bodies on the line, whatever that might look like. Mm-hmm. Right, and that's through conversations. It's literally going to a rally. It's all of these different things, but if we really want to see change, we have to do this. Mm-hmm. Right? We can't just sit back and go, let's have a lot of conversations, because that's a start. That's part mm-hmm. of awareness, right? You have to start there. Yes, mm-hmm. absolutely. It's essential. First step is awareness. Yes. We need to move beyond and go into action so that we can move into integration, which is the active ally model mm-hmm. that we're starting to put out there. And it's a process, mm-hmm. you know, and it's hard. But it's so worth it, because I mean, the way in which it's right now, it can't continue, and yet it does. Mm-hmm. And so we need more active allies, right? Not just safety pins, mm-hmm. right? So I think it's that too.
So when you say active, activism is a big part of this. It's taking knowledge, using your time to get educated, but then doing something about it. It's right. activism.
Right.
Like, really, that's what we're talking about.
Yeah. Yeah. And that can look like a conversation, right? Challenging language that's being used. It can look like changing your document so that you have lines for gender, so you have lines for race, so that people can, you know, tell you who they are. Mm-hmm. It's creating gender-neutral bathrooms, right? Like, when I got here, left one has urinals and one does not. Thinks I'd rather not use the urinal one, they usually smell, but I want to go here. But there was no gender associated to mm-hmm. that, right? So there are things that can be done that can create a space where folks can exist, mm-hmm. right? And then there's deeper ones, right? Again, it's who are you hiring? How are we hiring? Are you supporting sex workers' rights right now? Because they're going through it, right? Where are you on all of these? Because it's all connected.
I'm glad you brought that up. I was almost going to add this to the questions. What's going on with Craigslist right now? Is this affecting this?
Well, yeah. I mean, it's like one of the best ways I heard it explained was it's like, imagine that you wake up to go to work and the building's gone, the job's gone, the clients are gone, mm-hmm. and you have no way to access them.
And what we're referring to is, so Craigslist has decided to take off the personal section of their website where people would be able to meet, and they were meeting because they're a sex worker. They're meeting for all different reasons, right. but they took it off.
I forget the full name, but the FAFSA passed that said, created it, that made it so, and I'm not very good at this, I'm probably not the best person to speak deeply on this, but what it was is that I think it's a little confusing, but it creates certain aspects of online sex work mm-hmm. that it can be considered illegal, in which Craigslist would be held liable. And I think other websites had been shut down as well. I mean, like, this is real, and this is a livelihood.
And some of this, what we're really talking about, because I'm sure there's people listening that are right. like, why should I have empathy for a sex worker? Okay. And I think the reason that you shouldn't, you probably can add to this or help me on this, is that some people, because they are identified as being different, this might be their only way that they are able to earn income or really be themselves or authentically go out in the world representing themselves. So like, this is a real thing for them. Like, they're not going to be able to replace that income and go work at a conservative law mm-hmm. firm or something. I mean, you know, is that part of it?
Some, right? Again, you know, who's hiring who, and why aren't we yeah. hiring more trans people of color? And, you know, that's needs to be looked at as well. And, you know, sex work is also work, and folks, that's their job. That's what they want to be yeah. doing, right? It's not always, no other option, right? Like, just as I choose to be a facilitator, folks choose to do sex work, right? And the loss of these online ways of connecting makes it much more dangerous for folks to be able to do their work. Mm-hmm. And so part of my work as an active ally is I need to educate myself around this, mm-hmm. right? Like, so I don't know everything, and part of my process is I am becoming aware, and now I am learning, right? I don't know what my action is. Mm-hmm. I'm learning, and that's part of it, right? And so it's all steps. That's why when it feels overwhelming, it's just a reminder. It's just steps, mm-hmm. right? And we go through the process. We grow through the model of the phases. You know, you go through awareness, you figure out action, and as that integrates, those phases integrate into your being, new awarenesses come, mm-hmm. right? So
And it's easier too. It's like, right, it doesn't feel like so much work if you just take it, look at it as, right, steps, right, and then you go on to the next thing that you can learn and, right, where you can show support. And support, we talked about activism, but you know, support is like researching every business you're in business with, and like, mm-hmm, what are their policies? What are they doing? You know, is your, yeah, what is your banking? What is your bank doing that like you might not, right, agree with? Right. Should you change services like that? That's a big part of this, right, too. You know.
Right.
People, businesses think it's okay as long as nobody's talking about it or complaining, but you know, nothing shows there's a problem, yeah, more than taking your business somewhere else, you know. So that's an easy, right, not necessarily an easy thing to do. You got to do the research for it, but that's a way to support.
Right. Well, and folks have done that research, yeah, so you can probably just look up, you know, what is my bank into?
Yeah.
And you'll find something about it, because it's not hidden. Folks have done the work.
Well, we got to be careful of that too. But before the show, Kyle and I were talking about just content in, right, general, and how much is out there. So you know, right, don't read one article. Yeah. I'm informed.
Right.
You know,
no, that's
there
real.
Were the top things. You
that's
know,
real.
You,
yeah,
you have to challenge what you read. I think
absolutely,
that's a big thing that we need to do right now.
Thanks,
right,
for clarifying that. Yeah,
yeah,
absolutely.
No, it's good. I got your back on that.
Yeah,
one.
Yeah,
you're
cheers,
teaching me a lot. I'm gonna help you on that one. All right. What have we not talked about yet that we really need to talk about on this topic? So we've, mm-hmm, talked about being an ally, an active ally, should we explain what the difference between just an ally and an active? Why it was really important to talk about being active? I think we kind of have, but let's.
Well, yeah, and actually, again, we literally just posted a blog about this, the introduction to the active ally framework, and. I should have brought it with me because I could read it.
We can share it. I'll share the links in the archive.
Oh, brilliant.
Yeah.
But we use the term active because it needs to be clear that there is something to do, right? Often folks will claim ally as an identity, but that's all they're doing. And part of that, I think, is because folks don't have resources. They don't have the tools, right? Mm-hmm. So it's what we give you in our workshops over the tools and the resources. And we're learning how to find those resources, mm-hmm, right? So it's active is not just, or ally is not just, it's not just one thing, right? And so being an active ally requires awareness, it requires action, it requires integration, right? And when there's a article, how to know if your allyship is real or ally theater or something like, mm-hmm, that, and one that's about co-conspirators versus allyship, mm-hmm, right? And challenging what ally means, and it's the active part is integrating those challenges,
yeah,
as well.
I also, what kind of comes up for me in hearing you say that is active is embracing change, because there's always going to be change in the mix of this. There's going to be new issues, there's going to be, right, new things that people are experiencing, and so it's embracing change. Like, you don't get to read a book and go, okay, I'm an, right, ally, or I'm, right, I got this. It's, right, more like, you know what, change is going to come, and I'm going to be open to that, and I'm going, right, to take different action because of what I was just presented with.
Right. Well, and sometimes it's also like, you know, I don't know if this has happened to you, but I know it's happened to me where I've been called out on something, mm-hmm, right? I've been like, what, something I did was not okay. Mm-hmm. Sometimes you'll get called out in a way that's like easy to hear or whatever, mm-hmm, and then sometimes you won't. In either of those situations, the action is to listen, right? Is to take it in, mm-hmm, and to feel it, and that's okay if it hurts. Take that hurt elsewhere. Find your friends, you know, to help you through that. That's okay if you're hurt, but listen, take it in, and then apply it, right? It's a process.
Yeah.
You know?
Listening, we talk a lot about that.
Yeah.
I can't do that enough. That's a big part, right, of this. So, okay, that helps. I think really explaining, you know, the active part is really important. Let's look at some things that were in the media lately, so we can kind of apply how to be an ally maybe to the situation,
sure,
or reading. So these are just three articles that showed up in Google News in the last, I don't know, 24 hours, 48 hours. So the first one, the headline is, Roseanne's gender nonconforming character seems designed to appease to anti-trans feminists. I'm going to let you tell, I didn't even know there was a thing anti-trans feminists or why there would be feminists that are anti-trans. I had no idea. Like, this headline alone is really...
It's clickbait.
Yeah, well, of course. Yeah. It's so... Wow, there's a lot going on in there. And I can read some of the things that the article said. I'll tell you what I feel about it, and if there's an opportunity to learn from what I'm feeling about it, please tell me, and then also share what you're feeling. So I did watch the first Roseanne episode. Did you?
No.
I was curious.
No.
I wanted to watch it.
Yeah.
Wasn't really into it.
Right.
For a lot of reasons. It felt really forced. Like, there are lots of things just for ratings. It also felt like it kept people it gave them an excuse to be in a certain situation. Mm. Like, that was my general takeaway from it. Now, what this headline is about, so there's a character in the show now. It's her grandson. His name is Mark, and he's a young boy. He's probably like 10 or 12 years old, that is depicted as gender nonconforming. So he's this really vibrant kid that likes he's wearing girls' clothes to school, real just colorful, colorful kid. And so they address him in the show, and I can tell you about it. We can talk about it. My thoughts were, and how they addressed it, was, oh, they made it look really simple, and that's all they're going to have to do. And I don't even, like, I haven't watched it past the first issue, so maybe they're still dealing with it. But it was felt like, oh, this is how we're going to deal with this. That's easy. Next.
Right.
That's how I felt.
Sure.
What are your thoughts on this?
Roseanne's a transphobic, bigoted supporter of 45 racist. I don't...
And that's not his opinion, guys.
No, that's fact.
Yeah, she's well-documented transphobia. Yeah. She's associated with an anti-transgender ideology, the Westboro Baptist Church of Feminism. Right. She's tweeted about it. It's well-documented.
Right.
She said some pretty disgusting things against the trans community. Yeah.
Yeah, not just the trans community. Like, she's just an all-around bigot. So I don't spend a lot of time thinking about her or her show.
Yeah.
I did read the article, and you know, I think I guess I don't really have much thought on it.
I mean, it's hard because and that's why I really want to hear your opinion. Like, me watching, I'm like, well, it's great that they put this character in the show.
Yeah.
That's good, right? But then it's like, well, if they put it in and they vastly dismissed him, or you know. Address the situation, not the person, but the situation of how he was dressing, and then they don't talk about it anymore. I'm like, well, that's not really realistic. Like, this is like, again, a living, growing person that you're gonna love and learn about for the rest of your life. You know, like, don't address the person as an issue. Address the person as a person.
Well, yeah, I mean that too. It's just that. I'm sure I don't know what they are, but I'm sure there's shows out there, mainstream shows, that have done a better job.
Yeah.
But, you know, then it comes down to the question of who's benefiting from this.
Yeah.
Trans community's not benefiting from this, right? The only community that's benefiting from this is her community, right? And so it's
in a way like, what are we? Do you think that community is getting credit for, like, oh, we have empathy or we have understanding? Like,
no, I think it's just that she's this type of person, and those that I'm trying to come up with language, but I really don't have anything about. I could come up, but I haven't read enough. I haven't seen the show.
I appreciate you saying that. To be honest about it.
So I don't have much to say on it. It was an interesting article. They made an interesting point about it.
I'll share this one too, guys, so you guys can comment on it and get your thoughts around it. Okay, so let's move on to the next one. So the next one that I pulled was, this is the headline, and like Kyle said, it's clickbait. They're always mentally, ooh, that's sensationalized. Let's click on that. Mm-hmm. So the headline is, what's it like to be trans when both language and law refuses to recognize your identity? That's actually not that clickbaity. Mm-hmm. That's pretty straightforward. And this article was about, so this is on PRI.org. Members of the transgender community in Latin America have spent a lifetime navigating both the gendered Spanish language and the laws that don't recognize their identity. So just as an example in terms of language, the example they give in the article is El es guapo means he is handsome, and there's no way to put they there, or there's no language for them to like really incorporate trans language or transgender into their language. So they're fighting against that, and they can't. And then there's legal misidentity.
So, I want to be cautious of talking about a culture that neither of us are a part of. I don't know this language.
Uh-huh.
I'm learning it, but no matter if I become fluent or not, I'm not of the culture,
mm-hmm.
right? And so it's a good article. It gives you some insight about a culture, but I'm cautious of speaking on it,
mm-hmm.
Or having any kind of opinion, because part of being an active ally, mm-hmm. right, is understanding when you don't need to talk about something or when it's not something for you to dissect or think about, mm-hmm. or write a think piece on, as a lot of white people like to do, as we've seen. And I don't. I'm cautious. So I'm cautious.
It's fair.
Around that.
Yeah.
But I would share. If you're sharing these, share this one because it folks can learn something.
Yeah.
One of the things I know that we wanted to talk about, mm-hmm. in this was that this article used LGBTQIA.
Yes.
And they, lesbian, gay, bisexual, transgender, the Q being queer. I in this article is being used to represent intersex. And then A, which was confusing, said ally/asexual, which is just not okay. Right?
Yeah, one, so it's very two different meanings.
Two very different words and identities. And we don't give enough space for asexuality. And so to try to have one letter represent both, if you're going to use the acronym, is definitely problematic.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah.
Yeah, and I would like to trace the origin of where that's coming from, too,
mm-hmm.
like why we needed that. I've also heard the Q is questioning, not queer.
Oh, right.
But is that my question on something like this, and I think that this is why we need workshops and the work that you're doing, is this helping? You know, like, do we need to add more letters to what?
It depends on the purpose,
yeah.
right, of what you're talking about. If you're going to add the letters, then be all inclusive,
yeah.
right? Often you'll just see LGBTQ, which is what we often use if we use it. But it's important to be all inclusive. You can't put A for ally and asexual. You're erasing both, and especially asexuality, because folks are going to see A and go with ally because we don't have enough conversation around asexuality,
mm-hmm.
right? And so it's just that's problematic. I think in anything we do, it's the goal should be all inclusive as mm-hmm. best as possible when we're talking about identities. So I don't know. It depends. You know, mm-hmm. Some folks use it, some folks don't. There's the SOGI, sexual orientation, gender identity, and expression. For SOGIE,
mm-hmm.
is a one that's been floating around. I can't remember where it comes from.
That.
Yeah.
Why would someone prefer to use that over?
Well, that opens. I think that holds space for many identities,
mm-hmm.
right? And it's. SOGI is easy to say, right?
SOGI is
yeah.
easier.
But it does. It includes sexual orientation, gender identity, and expression.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that seems inclusive.
That, yeah,
yeah.
That actually feels a lot better
yeah.
Than adding more letters to.
Right. But then again, it's,
but
do what, you know, what makes sense mm-hmm. to you and what makes sense to the work that you're doing,
mm-hmm.
right? You know, that there's nothing wrong with letters.
No.
Do what you're going to do. Yeah, so, but you don't want to conflate two identities into one. That's just wrong.
Yeah.
It's just not good practice.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. And good news out of articles.
Yeah.
We could share this one. So Alaskans vote no on anti-transgender bathroom bill. So nearly 53% of voters in Anchorage, Alaska cast their ballots in opposition to a proposition that would have required transgender people to use public facilities that match their sex at their birth certificate.
Yeah.
That's cool. That's great.
Yeah, that's good news. That's cool.
53%.
Yeah.
Good for them.
Go. They worked hard. I read that article too, and they clearly worked hard to doorstep after doorstep. That's hard work.
Yeah.
I'm not somebody who can do that work.
That's not quick conversation.
Yeah,
that's like really sitting down and talking to people.
Yeah, well, it's also risking somebody like slapping or spitting you in the face because they don't agree. Like, it's hard work. They did good work. That's good news.
That's good news.
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah.
Well, I'd like to end on good news. All right. Well, let's switch gears a little bit.
So okay.
This is a heavy topic. It's important. And I don't think there's enough space for it.
Right.
And it feels like that in here. Sometimes, like, the energy kind of feel like we could be here for a couple hours and not even touch the surface.
Well, right. We have our workshop that we're doing for therapists. It's a 2-day workshop.
Yeah.
Right. And that's real. That's what it's about. But again, it doesn't. When it starts to feel heavy, when it starts to feel overwhelming, it's, you know, take a couple breaths, do whatever helps you ground yourself, and then think of one step.
Mm-hmm.
Right, it's just one thing.
That's good life advice.
That's all
period.
It is.
I mean, just everything. If you just take it down to like one step,
right.
You know, just take the first step and then take the next step, and
right.
You know, and don't look at it as this big overwhelming thing.
Right.
You know.
Yeah, I mean, you can feel the overwhelm sometimes to remind yourself why you're taking those steps, right? But yeah, so yeah, it can get heavy, but it doesn't. Think about it this way: it's heavy for us to talk about, and. We don't have to exist out in a world where we have to worry about being killed or put into jail another child sentenced to life in young African-American kid sentenced to life 63 years for a murder he didn't commit, but the police committed it, but he was there. I mean, right? So we don't have to worry about that. So when it starts to feel heavy, part of our privilege is that we have a system that supports our well-being, right? And so to lean into that, to remind ourselves, hey, no, wait a minute, I can take this step, right? So it's tough.
It's tough, but it's important.
All right, well, what are we switching
okay,
to?
Okay, let's so I just wanna learn a little bit more about you. So the best way that I can do this before we get in the show is just ask you an off-topic question.
Okay.
And the reason that I do this in terms of how, you know, relating is just to show that any given time, the way people are relating can change. We talked earlier about even, you know, you could be comfortable and then you're not comfortable, but it's really about embracing change. You don't get, being uncomfortable for a minute, and not to say these questions are gonna make you uncomfortable, but being uncomfortable for a minute is just an opportunity for growth. And it's a temporary situation. So I like being vulnerable.
I get to ask you questions
too? You can
too. All right, great.
Yeah, let's do it. I haven't done that in a while. I usually ask people to
do
that. So
Better being less uncomfortable in your seat, right? Because you're asking.
Yeah, I'll do two to you and you can do two to me.
All right, rock on.
All right, so the first one, what's the biggest crime you've committed?
So when I was 5, my brother convinced me that these loose Hot Wheels cars were free, that we could take them.
Yeah.
And he said, but don't tell mom because we can't. She doesn't want us to have them. So I put him in my little 5-year-old hand, and I had worn this dress that my mom had made, but the buttons wouldn't stay, right? And so as we're walking down, I think we were at a mall, she's like, button your dress. I'm like, I can't. She's like, why? I was like, I've got something in my hand. She's like, what? I was like, I can't tell you, right? Like, I'm 5.
Yeah.
And then she, you know, she's like, show me. So of course, and she sees, and she gets so mad, she takes me back, and I have to apologize, and I'm crying, and I'm so sorry, I don't know. And my brother's just standing there like, you know, he doesn't know what's going
older?
On. Yeah, he's 3 years older.
And peer pressure.
Yeah, that's probably the worst.
You learn early.
That's the worst one I'm willingly share.
It's probably a good idea.
Right.
All right, so the next question is,
your turn.
Okay.
Hold on. All right, let's see.
We'll go back and forth.
No, I don't like that one.
All right.
Nope. Okay, would you rather have everyone love you, this is horrible, everyone love you but hate yourself, or in the reverse?
Oh, good Lord. Yeah, some of them are a little superficial.
That's horrible.
I think self-love is really important. I really do. Yeah. I mean, I think that that creates more change and, you know, being able to be authentic and caring about yourself just allows you to connect with other people. So yeah. I don't really put too much emphasis on people not liking me. There's going to be people that don't like me and hate me. I mean,
but what if everyone, this is everyone, so you have all the self-love.
Everybody
hates. Everybody, how do you cultivate self-love when everything around you is hate?
Yeah, I don't know.
Yeah, well, that's
I think nature. They have to like about, go to an island or something. I don't know. Yeah, so I'm also anti-isolation. I think that's one of the worst things that we could do to a human being. I think the measures of isolation that they use in prisons is just horrific.
Yeah, we need to abolish all prisons.
Yeah. Yeah. So, yeah, that's a tough one.
Yeah. Yeah, all right.
You want your next one? One's goofy. Is it worse to discover your fly is down, spinach in your teeth, or toilet paper stuck to your shoe?
Interesting. I don't really know. I just, I would hope somebody would tell me if of the three were happening. Let's see, what would be worse? I guess spinach, because I don't like the feeling of stuff stuck in my teeth, so I imagine I'd feel it.
Yeah.
Other than that, you know.
That's the hardest one to get to, too, because toilet paper you can get to.
Right.
Scar your flat you can get to. But, it's a little more difficult to have to deal with that.
I think I had a dream last night where I didn't have a zipper, and so I couldn't fix my eyes. I think I did.
That's crazy.
It's weird. All right, here we go.
Okay.
What fear have you outgrown?
That's a great question.
Yeah.
What fear have I outgrown? I actually think the fear of being alone. Mm. I mean, I live alone. It's kind of odd that I'm saying this because a couple weeks ago I fell in my place and had a mild concussion and kind of like that shifted things. But the fear of being alone in terms of what society deems as being alone, so like not having identity through a relationship, I don't feel alone in the world, even though people will say, oh, I feel so bad. You live alone. You know, you're alone.
Right.
But I don't, I think getting over that, you know, or maybe it's not even getting over, but just kind of coming to terms with that. That's part of who I am right now.
Yeah.
Now.
Yeah.
You know? Yeah. I think that's what I'd say. I'm trying to think if there's any other fear. Yeah. No. That's probably the biggest one.
Yeah, that's a tough one. I think a lot of people struggle with being alone.
Yeah.
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 That's real.
Yeah.
Sweet.
Sweet. All right. I feel like I know you better after that exercise. Kind of cool. I should just do all of those. All right.
Right.
So there's one last thing that we do on the show, Kyle, that I call a heart swell. And it's just essentially giving somebody a shout out, like just expressing some deep feelings towards a person. It could be a group of people that you just really, truly believe deserves some acknowledgement. And the reason that I ask everybody to do it is just to show it's not that hard. And to hopefully encourage people to do it too, you know, to pick up the phone and call somebody and say, you know, I just wanted to tell you, you mean something to me and I appreciate you. So are you willing to do it, first of all?
Well, I don't know yet, but what I will tell you, the hard part is not telling those you love that you appreciate them. Maybe the first couple of times it's a little awkward and uncomfortable, but it's, something I practice in my friendships. Mm-hmm. And sometimes it's awkward for the other person, and I know I can get real mushy sometimes, and I don't even care. But it's so important to do that, to tell people that just, you know, I appreciate you.
Yeah.
I just who you are, I appreciate you. Mm-hmm. Not what you do for me, not just you.
Yeah.
And so what I would rather do, I think, is for folks that wanna educate themselves. Mm-hmm. I would recommend Janet Mock, who has two books out now. She's a wonderful activist. Check out The Body Is Not an Apology.com. Mm-hmm. It's a great resource. Who else? Let me think. Oh, and read our blog.
Awesome.
We're building a resources page, so we'll have more out there. But check out Building Allies. But mostly these two for. Janet Mock is accessible. She's brilliant. She answers a lot of the questions that people have. Her work is it's a good read. And The Body Is Not Apology talks about many layers of ways in which people can show up and be an active ally. And Sonia Renee Taylor. She has a new book out.
I'll make sure to get all of those links for
Brilliant.
You, so
okay.
we'll share them in the archive.
Great.
So everybody, don't worry if
Great.
You didn't have a pen handy. We'll share all of those when we archive the show, so
Ryan.
You can find the book, find his blog, you know,
Rock
all
on.
Kinds of resources.
Rock on.
Amazing. I really like the time today. I mean, like I said, I feel like there's more. This is just our first step, you know,
yeah.
our first step of having this conversation. And right. maybe it's your first step of hearing it for the first time. And,
yeah.
You know, you can use these resources to get more knowledgeable. You can find, if you're here in Los Angeles, you can go to the workshop that's held at my favorite place. What's my favorite place, everybody? TRC, the Relational Center. You hear me talk about it all the time.
Yeah.
What's the date on that?
That's it's a continuing educational workshop for mental health professionals. It's April 15th and the 22nd, and you can find links to sign up. I guess I'll send them to you, but
yeah.
also on our Facebook page, on our website, and at the Relational Center. So
awesome, and we'll yeah. be sharing all of that. So I really appreciate you being
yeah.
here, Kyle.
Rock on.
Website is buildingallies.org. Mm-hmm. Social media across the board, Building Allies.
Yeah.
You can find and reach out to you and your team
mm-hmm.
members there.
Mm-hmm.
Next week, the guests will be Brittany Ballard, who is a filmmaker, and she did a short film on shame, and it is pretty, I mean, I've seen it, and just thinking about it, I just got goosebumps, because it's a topic we don't really talk about
yeah.
that much. How do we deal with shame? And we're actually going to play a little clip of it on the show, so we're going to be talking about filmmaking and her story, but also just the topic of shame,
mm-hmm.
which I'm kind of excited about. But
yeah, cool.
I appreciate you being here. One last thing we're going to do together. So I usually issue some sort of social challenge for people to try
okay.
for the week. And I think there's lots of ideas from what we've talked about. Maybe it's just reading some of these resources that we
right.
talked about. What else would you suggest? Like, as people are out in the world, and maybe a step that they can take before reading a resource, just being
mm-hmm.
out
mm-hmm.
in the world that they could try this week.
Mm-hmm.
Does anything come to mind?
Sure. Well, it depends, right? Depending on where you are in your mm-hmm. process, if you're stepping into awareness, then your challenge would be to be aware, right? Pay attention to the ways in which maybe you receive something that somebody else doesn't, or language that's used. If you're within awareness and you're looking for an action, you'll hear something, no doubt, say something, challenge it, make a request at work, you know, read a book.
I like it. So what yeah. Kyle's talking about is,
Thank
you know, we talked about earlier about privilege. And again, we're not saying, you know, privilege is a bad thing, but you different people have it just
mm-hmm.
simply because of how they look. So acknowledging or just paying attention, I think awareness is the right idea, that
mm-hmm.
somebody had a different experience than you
mm-hmm.
and look at them and go, well, why? And be able to challenge that, you know, think about that. I think if you're The step one is really just awareness. If you're not okay
right.
with saying anything right away,
right.
that's okay. But I think just having the awareness starts to give you an idea of like,
right.
oh, you know, this thought that I had or this opinion that I
hmm.
had, you know, maybe it's off. It's
right.
skewed because
right.
I'm only seeing it through me. I'm
right.
not seeing it through the world or through other people. So
right.
there's a lot of opportunity to grow in this one exercise of just
yes.
paying attention. So like you're in a service situation, anything.
Right.
And just pay attention to how people are talking to each other or
right.
words that are, words, facial expressions, different
right.
things. That's a great exercise.
Yeah, do that.
Yeah,
that's good
do
stuff.
Do that. All right. And if you do it, you can reach out to either one of us. Tell us
yep.
about it. So
that would be awesome. Yeah.
Yeah. Tell us about
yeah.
it. We'd love to hear from you. So that brings us to the end of another show. I really
Cheers.
Appreciate you being here.
Yeah, thank you.
Good,
thank you.
It's a great time. You know, good learning and, I'm actually thinking about steps now, you know, things
Rock
I can
on.
Do. So I'm encouraged and inspired. I hope you guys are too. As always, if you take the social challenge or you had some thoughts, questions about anything that we talked about, you can reach out to me on Twitter at LoveMoreNow or Instagram at RelateWithSteph. And then watch for the archive of the show on StephanieMichelle.com, which will have all the things that we talked about, the
Perfect.
Links that you can get in touch with Kyle or
yeah.
any of these resources that we talked about.
Yeah, sweet.
Sweet. So that's the end of the show. As always, I'm just going to encourage everybody to relate with more curiosity.
Mm-hmm.
See you next week.